Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, I stand before you today to call into question the nature of leadership, to call into question the razor's edge that separates motivation and decimation. Today I want to talk about how an egotistical man with morbid hatred in his heart used the psyche of his players as a personal playground to vent his twisted ideals of leadership. I'd like to talk about a man who clearly has no respect for the game and somehow less for its athletes. Today you are the judge, the jury, and the executioner in the trial of Mike Keenan. Iron Mike Keenan. His career began at the Forest Hills Collegiate Institute in Ontario. He coached their varsity hockey team, then moving to the Oshawa Legionnaires and back-to-back titles. This landed him a job with the Peterborough Petes, then further the Rochester Americans of the AHL. Even in his neophyte pre-NHL stage, all accounts pointed to a vindictive and arrogant man. Rumors have it that his team despised him in Rochester. This forced him back to the University of Toronto, where he'd win a CIAU championship. His success with an utterly stacked Toronto team garnered him his first big break, head coach of the Philadelphia Flyers. Seeing some success there, he began to earn his nickname Iron Mike. Not because he was strong as iron like heavyweight champion Mike Tyson, no. He was nicknamed Iron Mike for his ruthless, solid, and cold attitude to his players, not to forget his stubbornness and psychological attacks. His fierce manipulation would lead to interesting results of success early, but as players grew weary of his mentality, the teams he coached would degenerate over time, almost always starting successful, then crashing back to earth.
I don't believe a word he says, Your Honor. He's crazy.
Order.
He's trying to steal my
gun. Order in the court. Order in the goddamn court.
Sorry, Agnes.
He'd later coach the Chicago Blackhawks between 1988 and 1993. During that run, he'd coach the Canadian national team using his signature brand of tyrannical rule. Here, he would start Brett Sutter over Steve Yzerman, claiming that Steve isn't as good as he thinks he is. This is, as usual, a mental ploy to manipulate the team into deifying him, elevating himself as the iconic figure hovering above the players. This is a running theme with Mike. It isn't enough to win. It's all meaningless if he doesn't look like the sole reason for success. He'd leave in 94 for arguably the most stacked team of all time, with no less than 8 future first ballot Hall of Famers, including Mark Messier, Glenn Anderson, Alex Kovalev, Brian Leetch, Sergei Zubov, and others. Any normal coach would feel incredibly blessed to have such a wealth of talent. He'd do anything to stick around and attempt to establish a dynasty. But due to a mixture of the team's stature being seen as more responsible for the success than his genius, and the large market and stars of New York being unusually unyielding to his mental torture, he couldn't get out of there fast enough. By the end of the Stanley Cup run, he was already negotiating deals with other teams. During a regular season game, he attempted to punish Alex Kovalev for taking long shifts, forcing him to stay on the ice and having other players block the door. In total, Kovalev's shift would last 7 minutes, concluding the second period. In that time, he would draw 3 penalties and score a go-ahead goal. In many ways, this was emblematic of his time as a Ranger. He couldn't fail, even when he was trying to. By the end of that season, the New York Rangers would overwhelm the Vancouver Canucks in one of the greatest 7-game Stanley Cup finals in history. Instead of using that as a springboard to a dynastic endeavor, he jumped ship immediately and became coach of the St. Louis Blues. Here he would inherit a man we'll get to know much better later on, arguably the greatest natural goal scorer of all time, Brett Hull. His atrocities with the Blues are well documented, but we'll save that for the future. Later in his tenure, he would acquire the greatest player in the sport's history, Wayne Gretzky, for a playoff run. One story claims he'd frequently go around the dressing room maligning, insulting, and screaming at every player after losses, sparing only the great one. This further sowed dissension in the ranks. As the playoffs arrived, the Blues would face the Detroit Red Wings. The series would stretch to a 7th game overtime, where Steve Yzerman, the man Mike Keenan left on the bench proclaiming he wasn't as good as he thought he was, would rifle one of the most iconic slapshot goals in NHL overtime history. His career spiraled from there, never really being able to regain any kind of footing. He'd visit Vancouver, reuniting with Messier, but tear apart one of the most talented teams of its era with his mind games. Before a crucial game, Lyndon tried to rally the troops in the midst of a losing spiral. Keenan burst in the door calling him a loser, saying that he had never done anything but lose, and that he would always be a loser, and most of all, he should shut up. Eventually, some of the most beloved players in franchise history, like Lyndon, Bure, and McLean, would be chased out of town. Soon after, he would be chased from the league entirely inland in Russia, possibly the only place where he may feel at home. He'd have some success there, being the only coach in history to win a championship in the NHL and the KHL. But largely, he will be remembered for his mental torment, ruthless tactics, and squandering of talent. Your Honor, I'd like to call my first and only witness to the stand. A man with a Stanley Cup winning goal in overtime. A man with 741 career goals, including an 86 goal season. I'd like to call Brett Hull. What do you have to say about Mike Keenan?
Keenan was just, he was mean, he was mean-spirited. He almost was doing it out of pleasure to belittle people and to make trades that were just asinine, little things like that. He'd come in the room, and the only guy I'd ever seen do this was after a morning skate, he'd come in and tell the trainers to move guys from one area in the dressing room to another area in the dressing room, and it's just like, why? You know, and he didn't treat the trainers well. He didn't treat anyone well.
What is the worst thing you remember him doing?
Well, there's things you do and there's things you don't do. And Dale Hawerchuk's a Hall of Famer. Probably could be top 100 of all time, like we just had voted in. And his grandmother was dying, and it was gonna be, he's from just outside Buffalo. And we were going to play the Sabres, and his grandmother was coming to watch him play for the last time. And Mike Keenan sat him out on purpose. And I snapped on Mike Keenan. And that's when he took my C away. And I was like, I don't, you can take it. That's the lowest thing I've ever seen in my life, what you just did to that guy.
A man's dying grandmother comes to watch him for the last time, and in his usual malicious fashion, he has to do something mean-spirited, troublesome, and needless. Once again, elevating himself above his soldiers and causing chaos. These are not the actions of a noble leader nor a man whose goal is to win. This is the action of a sick, twisted person. A self-centered being. Someone who isn't satisfied with success if he isn't its main reason. And worst of all, someone who takes pleasure in the pain and suffering of his players.
The prosecution is not gonna get that man today. No. Because I'm gonna get him.
Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, I understand that tough love is a tried and true coaching method. I understand that sometimes you have to push people so they can do things that they didn't think possible. But what we've witnessed over the course of this man's career is nothing short of tyranny, malevolent and tactical manipulation and domination, leading to squanderings of incredible talent. This is truly one of the most evil men in NHL history, because if all his monstrous behavior had been in service of desperate need for victory, it would be in some ways redeeming. But ultimately, he only cared to feed his own ego and his own grandeur. Mike the Rat Keenan deserves to go down as the most evil man in NHL history.